Hello friends, this video on Evolution Part 6 is brought to you by examfear.com. No more fear from exam. Next evidences came up from fossils. So let us see, what are fossils? So fossils are preserved remains of living organisms from remote past. So sometimes what happens is, in past some organisms used to live. So their remains are present quite below, deep inside the soil. So sometimes when you dig the soil, you get some of those fossils, and looking at those fossils, you get a lot of information about the organisms which were existing in those days. Now these fossils may vary from very microscopic, for example a single bacterial cell can also be found as a fossil, to it can be as large as the size of a dinosaur. So the fossils of a dinosaur has also been found. So fossil mainly preserves only a portion of the dead organism, mostly that is the case. You do not get the entire organism skeleton as it is, but sometimes either the skeleton is got, or sometimes you get the bone or the teeth of an organism. So that means you just get a part of the organism. So something like this. So here you can see some of the examples of fossils. So here you can see it is the skeleton part. So this is a fish. So looking at the fossil, you can actually get an idea about the structure of that organism, what was that organism. So that is how fossil helps us to find evidences about evolution. Now the question is, how are fossil layers formed? Now fossils are formed in layers. So the deeper you go, what does that mean? The fossil is going to be more old, right? Because as time passes, more and more layers of soil will get formed. So the deeper that fossil is being found, that means it is, the older it is. So somewhat like this. So let us see, how are these fossil layers formed? Now as I said, let us suppose there was a time when these organisms used to be there. Now what happens, as years passes by, these organisms, they live their lifespan, they die, and then what happens? A new generation comes in when new organisms have formed. So let us suppose this is the generation when the dinosaurs leave. So what happens to these organisms? They are dug inside the soil. Now again, after one generation passes, let us suppose these organisms also died, so they are buried under the soil, so they form another layer. So if you see, as time passes by, the number of fossil layers keep on increasing. So here the layer which is the bottommost, so the bottommost layer is going to be the oldest. So that means this was existing much before than the one which is at the topmost, and the topmost layer would represent the most recently lived organism. So that is how, looking at the layer of fossil, you can determine the time duration when that organism used to live. And looking at the fossil, as I said, the fossil will give you a lot of information. It can give you the structural information of that organism. It can give you the time period when that organism used to live. It can also tell you its similarity or differences with other organisms, because looking at the structure, you can actually predict a lot of things, and that is how you can establish the evolutionary relationships. So how do you estimate the age of fossils? As I said, deeper the layer where the fossil is found, older it is. So as you go deeper, so the older you are actually. So that is one important thing while estimating the age of fossils. Another important thing to be noted in mind is age estimation detecting ratios of isotopes of different elements. So by calculating by determining the composition of the fossils can also help you to determine the age of fossil. So let us see how. What happens is, each isotope of any element, each isotope will have a specific half-life. So by now I think all of you know what is half-life. So when you talk about radioactivity, you talk about these terms, half-life. That means the time by which the radioactivity of that element reduces to half its original value. Okay, so now each and every isotope will have a specific half-life of its own. So let us take example of carbon. So carbon is an element and it has got two isotopes, carbon-12 and carbon-14. Now, carbon-12 and carbon-14, they are both isotopes of each other. That is, they have the same atomic number but different mass number. Now, both of them will have their specific half-lives. Now, knowing the isotopes, we will know their half-lives. Now, with that, we can calculate for how long is it there, because you all know how we calculate half-life, right? So when you are able to calculate half-life, you actually get to know that since how long, because what is half-life? Half-life means by the time its radioactivity reduces to half. So if you know the half-life, you actually can calculate how much radioactivity has got reduced till that time. So once you know that, you can calculate the duration for which that isotope is lying there. So with that, we can calculate for how long it is there, which in turn will help us to give a rough idea about the age of the fossil, because the fossil is after all made up of those isotopes of the elements. So this is another way of calculating the age of fossils. Because just looking at the fossil layers will just give you a very vague and rough idea. Because the layers, as you see, the deeper you go, it will be older, that's fine. But you will not get an exact idea of exactly how old it is. You just get a rough idea. Or you can get a relative idea about which fossil is older than which fossil by comparing their depth under the soil. But when you talk about this isotope technique to calculate the age estimation, you will get a more specific data with this technique. So I hope you understood how we will calculate it with the help of half-life. So half-life is generally denoted by T half. Okay. So now let us see how do fossils give evidences for evolution. So what exact information do these fossils give? So fossils at upper layers are more complex than that at the lower layers. Now, as I said, fossils which are at the upper layers, they are newer. So they are newer when compared to the fossils which are at the lower layer. And it has been found that the newer fossils, that means the organisms which came later, they are more complex than the organisms which existed earlier. And from this, we can conclude that the way evolution happened in such a way that simple organisms evolved or gave rise, or complex organisms evolved from simple organisms. So this is one thing that was told by the fossils. Fossil records show that there is a link between birds and reptiles. Now, a fossil record has been found where we found a skeleton, or where we found remains of an organism which had similarities with birds as well as with reptiles. So if you look at this picture, this is the picture of a dinosaur. Now, dinosaurs are nothing but the land reptiles. They have become extinct now, but they were existing somewhere around more than 65 million years ago. So that time they used to exist. So these dinosaurs, they were basically reptiles, but some of the dinosaurs were modified with feathers and wings, so they resembled birds. So we can say that these kind of organisms were a link between the reptiles and the birds. And gradually, with these kind of small changes, birds evolved out of reptiles. So this is another evidence which shows that there can be a link between different organisms. So you see, these actually got modified to these many birds which we see now. So the modification happened gradually, and that is why the look of the birds also changed with time. And this link between birds and reptiles is known as Archaeopteryx, and that is the name. So as you can see here, Archaeopteryx. So that is the name given to the fossil record, which acts as a link between a bird and a reptile. Fossil records show how evolution occurred in some mammals with time. For example, if you look at these mammals like horse, elephant or camels, we see that over a period of time, their evolution occurred gradually. So when the horses evolved, they just do not evolve like that, the way we see them today. So the evolution was quite gradual. So gradually some of the features got changed, and finally, we saw it how we see it today. So this is how some of the evidences given by the fossils also tell us that evolution had taken place. That means the organisms were related to each other and one organism came up from another organism. So there was an evolutionary relationship existing between different
Thank you. Please visit examfear.com for an easy 4-step learning process absolutely free of cost. Watch video lessons, ask questions, refer notes, and take an online test. Thank you once again.